Hi, I'm Scott Noonan, CEO of Audio Advice. This video is all about doing a Dirac calibration. And I just want to give you a little bit of preface before we go into it. First, as you might imagine at Audio Advice, we've used pretty much every calibration tool out there. And I've got to say, if you're about to use Dirac, you've got one of the best, if not the best, calibration tools that exists in the world today. It is truly incredible. So there's a few levels of Dirac I'll just point out as you're getting ready to calibrate. Some of the original products or core products that are out, they have the light version of Dirac, meaning you can calibrate up to about 500 hertz. For most people, that's going to be enough. They're trying to get the lower bass addressed in their room. Then as you go up into generally more expensive products, what happens is the manufacturer of the product cuts a deal with Dirac and it pays for what you get in it. So if you get into things like Arcam, it comes with the full version of Dirac built into it. And then when you get up into something like a JBL synthesis processor, you actually also get full bass optimization. So there's three different versions there. You'll see you can actually upgrade your versions. What I'm going to show is the full version, but it's exactly the same to do it for 500 hertz and below. If you've got the light version, there's obviously a little bit additional value going to the full version, but it, you know, it's incremental. Then if you go to full bass management, Dirac Live Bass Control, I show that at the end of the video. Most people don't have that, and it's an upgrade for most systems out there, unless it's something like the JBL synthesis processor. I would really only recommend that if you've got, say, three or more subs. The real advantage is it's blending your subs with all of the other speakers and trying to figure out all the right crossovers everywhere else. But I've done a lot of calibrations on it. I think for most people, you got one sub, maybe two subs, it's not necessary. Again, really hardcore people, really into it, then you're gonna wanna do it. And I'll show it both ways. So first things first, what you wanna do is set up your processor or your receiver, and then make sure your room is identical to the way that you would be watching a movie. So in other words, if you've got curtains closed, make sure they're closed. If you've got seats out, all the things that you would do so that the room is set up exactly how you would use it. The next thing you need to do is I want you to turn off any fans you've got, turn off any HVAC systems, anything that's giving you background noise. The trick in calibrating well is having as good a signal to noise ratio as you can possibly have. Then go through, set up your processor as you always would. In other words, set your distances, go in and set your SPL levels, everything so that if your Dirac's ever turned off, it works well, but also this will speed up your Dirac process. And I'll talk a little bit more about that when we get into it. So, with all that said, I'm now going to jump in and I'm going to screen record and show you me calibrating in a room that's got a full five-channel system. We've got four in the ceiling and we've got four subs. So it's a full system out there and you'll just get a full sense of it. I'll speed through some parts a little bit faster. With that, let's jump into the recording. When you first open up the software, you're going to see any Dirac Live devices that are on the system, in this case, the Arcam AV40. You need to make sure they're on the same network. Okay, so on this page is where you set up your mic. You'll see on the left is the mic that's in the computer. Obviously, you don't want to use that one. On the right is a much nicer mic. As you might imagine, we calibrate them at Audio Advice. We use really nice mics. You right-click here, and you'll see the calibration files right below it, but you'll be able to load any calibration file. Nice mics all come with them. So if you've gotten an Arcam, for instance, the mic came with it. There's also a text file that you get that you'll load up here. It's pretty simple. Every time you go in afterwards, it'll be there. One thing of note, when you set up your mic and you're actually putting it in the room, you're going to generally want the mic sitting straight upwards. In other words, the microphone itself is facing the ceiling. And you'll use that for all your calibrations, no matter where it sits. Let's go ahead and move on. Now we're gonna move on to actually setting the different levels. Now, before I talk you through what you're seeing on the screen right now, let me give you a little bit of background. One, when you set up your processor of AVR, make sure that you put in all of the exact speakers. In other words, you know, your left, center, right, whether you've got surrounds or rears first. The second thing you'll do is go ahead and put in your speaker distances and your levels. If you do that, there should not be much work on the page that you see here. What this page is really doing is putting everything at about the same level when it plays the test tones. So when you go into this page, if all of your levels and distances are set, you should really be able to just change the master output you see there on the left and adjust it. And almost every one of the speakers, when you click play below it, should show up with green. And so you'll see in this case, when I hit it on the front right, you'll see me go up into the green area. What you want is every speaker to be in the green area. It's essentially putting every speaker within a similar loudness gain level. In this case, I'm walking through one by one. Don't change the mic gain. If you look over on the left, leave the mic gain 100% because you want your signal to noise to be as good as you possibly can get it. So you're gonna adjust the master output, which changes the SPL level of everything coming out, and then tweak every speaker to the right amount so they all show up in green. You've already got your subs. If you've got a powered sub, you'll have that already set into a neutral level and have already run your calibration software on it, preferably in advance. If you don't, obviously this will calibrate it as well within the system. Now I'm gonna just speed it up for purposes of this video, and you can see I just need to get everything into the green. So just work your way through, and this is basically a balance of setting the master volume and then adjusting each speaker. So for instance, you can see that for my top left and rights, I have the gains really high up there because those are smaller speakers. Okay, I go to the next level. I'm gonna choose focus imaging. There you could have chosen, I want a full couch or spread the imaging or have it focused. Now here, you're gonna choose the first place to measure. You'll see I chose it right in the middle. It'll always have you do that. That is the most important measurement. So make sure your microphone is set there. There's no noise in the room. You've turned off all your HVAC systems, fans, anything else to do this first calibration. And it's gonna run through test tones. Again, I'm speeding it up, but it'll run test tones. And now I've completed the measurement from the very first center position. The rest of these positions you can actually do in any order that you want. You can bounce around and test them. Ideally, do as many as you can possibly do. As it gets up to a larger number, you get to 7, 8, 9. Obviously, the incremental benefits reduce. So I'm speeding it up here. You see, I've done now 7 different ones, and I'm gonna move over to proceed to filter design. I'll click on it, and again, I'm gonna speed this up through the pre-processing, but there's a bunch of math that happens that's really cool. Okay, so now you can actually see the curve that came out from all of the listening, and you'll see first I showed you sort of left, right, what the curves were in the center. Notice what I'm doing here. I can actually grab the center because it's a similar speaker as left and right and group it. So it automatically groups the speakers that would naturally be the same. It had the center different. I can put it in here so I could actually adjust my curve one time and it would apply to all three. Obviously you can see the center's a little bit different, so I'm pulling it out. You can see my left and right surrounds. In the subs, you'll see they follow a very similar curve because they're the same speakers that are in the system. And here you can see, you actually have a curtain. You can pull this curtain forward and backward to basically say, don't change anything outside of the curtain. Again, jumping into the center here, what I want to show you is you could actually just export this and put it right into your processor. But you see these areas where it's having to increase the speaker quite a bit, the gain to match the target curve. You can zoom in like I'm doing here. And what I want you to do is try not to ever have the gain go over about 6 dB increase for any frequency. And the reason is it starts pushing the speaker too hard in that frequency and you don't want to damage the speaker or really pull away from anything else. So you'll notice here, I'm just going to adjust it to follow the natural path of the speaker itself, and I'm just so it doesn't have to add quite as much gain. You can add as many points as you want. Again, I just zoomed in and I'm going to add these points. I'm not going to go through every single one, but you get the point. Instead of just exporting exactly as it comes out, if you see that you've got areas where it really is having to increase the gain a lot from the natural curve of the speaker that comes out to the loaded curve, just go through and do these adjustments you see I'm doing here, and you can do it in any place. I could also do it over there. You'll see in the lower frequencies, it's sort of 400 hertz, etc. Now I've zoomed back out and you can get a sense, and I would go through and do this in most places here where it drops quite a bit. The other thing I'll mention is some of the nicer processors come with their own curve. So what's in here by default is the Dirac curve. If you've got a Harmon product like Arcam or JBL, you can actually click up in the on this curve, and it will allow you to download the Harmon curve. And they've come up with what they think is the optimal curve for mid-size speakers or subs, et cetera. And so that's pretty cool as well. But what you're seeing right here are the Dirac curves, which is a pretty standard curve that you'll see. Now I'm looking at the subs. You'll see there's some areas that I would correct where it looks like it's having to pull the sub up. And by the way, these corrections, I think, tend to make more sense down in the lower frequencies on subs. So for instance, you can see here, somewhere around 40 to 50 hertz, I've got this dropout. If I tried to push it more than about 6 dB, let's say I pushed it up 10 dB to hit that curve from what the room was calculating, you're just gonna have way too much pushing in that one frequency, which is going to sort of bottom out the sub, and it's just, you're not going to hear it as well in the other frequencies, or the sub itself will, you know, fully bottom out. So you make these little adjustments through. Again, I'm not making them all, I'm just giving you a sense of how they work. And then you see down here, you can actually export the filter. So now I proceed to the export. I can name it. I've got three opportunities in the Arcam piece, so I can actually do different calibrations. Say one that I want to pull up bass, etc. I'm saving this one as demonstration in Dirac. It's now exporting it to the device. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to add full bass optimization. So you have to pay more to get this unless you have the JBL or some of the more advanced pro equipment, but with full Dirac Live bass control, you'll see it overrides my crossovers. You'll see right here at 46.1 hertz, and I will go through and show you a different example. So if you look at my front, left, and right, it dropped it all the way down to 26.9. So in this room, these are full range front, left, and centers. And because of that, Dirac saw that it should move more bass into those to spread the bass across the room. And so theoretically, this is just a killer idea because it's finding the perfect crossover for each speaker to provide the best bass response throughout the room. So for instance, if you only had one or two subs. I'll make one point here, which is I found you really need to have three or more subs to make it worth going to full bass optimization. So most systems will not need that, but I just wanted to show you how to do it here. Again, if you've got questions about this, feel free to give us a call at Audio Advice. You can go to audioadvice.com. You can chat with us, email us, give us a call. Or if you're in North Carolina, drop by our Charlotte or Raleigh showrooms, and we'll be happy to help you out.